Welcome to the Band of Brothers. We meet each Friday morning at 6:30 at the First Baptist Church in Garden City. Our guests have spent some time this morning greeting each other and enjoying a hot breakfast. Now, let's get our Bible study underway.
Guys, we're in Genesis, so find your places in Genesis chapter number 47 again. We're trying to hack through this. We won't probably need to finish, go through verse by verse through all of this in chapter number, as we get to the end of the book of Genesis. But I do want to show you in the life of Joseph, how Joseph so pictures Jesus Christ in so many things. He is an Old Testament picture of Jesus. When we pointed out to you that the whole Bible is about the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the one hero. He's the hero of the Bible. He is the Redeemer. He's the Restorer. He's the Captain of our salvation. He's the one who won and purchased for God a people by his own blood. And so Jesus is the great hero of the Bible. And so we look at the people, places, and things that remind us of Jesus. When Jesus walked with the Emmaus Road disciples, remember, and he opened unto them the scriptures, and they were able to see all those things concerning Christ from the Old Testament. We've made a big, big deal about that, and it's true. So that's why Joseph is such a person of interest to us. Startling similarities in his life and career, we might say, what has happened in his life and how it pictures the Lord Jesus Christ and how he is portrayed in the Word of God. And so remember, when we were here last week, we talked about how Jacob goes in to see Pharaoh. In verse number 10, Jacob blessed Pharaoh and went out from before Pharaoh. He blessed him. The greater blessed the lesser. Jacob was just an old shepherd with leather tough skin and a pronounced limp. And he comes limping into the Oval Office of that day and pronounces a blessing upon Pharaoh, who's absolutely amazed at Jacob. And you might can see and feel and sense that in his mind the wheels were really turning till he asked Jacob, "How old are you?" And Jacob tells him, and notice what Jacob says here in verse number 9. He says, "The days of my pilgrimage are 130 years." I love this about Jacob. Number one, not just the longevity of his life, but he understood what life was. You know what he called his life? A pilgrimage. A pilgrimage. A pilgrim is someone going home. He understood that he was moving through this world. This was not all it. And we as Christians must keep a pilgrim spirit. We must realize that life is just that, a pilgrimage. We are moving through. We are not here to stay. Nowhere in the Bible do you ever see where where Abraham or Isaac or these men had houses. They were what? They just had tents. They lived a very transient life. And they would pull up those tent pegs and they would move. And that's how we ought to live. We ought to live with the idea that the place where we're going, a city where we're going, has foundation, a city that's built by God, a permanent place. But right now we're only pilgrims, and we're not to try to lay foundations and stay here. We'll try to impact here. We'll try to have fruit that remain here, right? Like the blessed man, that man in Psalm 1. We ought to try to have an impact throughout eternity, and we do that by talking about eternal things and sharing eternal things and dealing with eternal matters and speaking with eternal. What are the two eternal things in this world? The two things that's going to last forever in this world today, only two: the Word of God and the souls of men. Boy, I tell you what, that ought to be the areas of interest in our lives. The Word of God, right? And the souls of men. So we're to have an impact. But this is not all there is, guys. So I know he says, listen, I live to be 130 years old. And he says, these are the days of my pilgrimage. I'm just moving through. And he understood that. And then notice what he says. Few and evil have the days of the years of my life been. He says, I've had some trouble in my life. And it's been a short life. I mean, 130 years, you know, boy, you say, boy, that's a long time. He says, man, I'm a whippersnapper when it comes to how long I lived. In fact, his daddy lived to be 180. His granddaddy lived to be 175. Abraham lived to be 175. His daddy lived to be 180. So he says, I'm a whippersnapper. He says, few and evil have the days of years of my life been, and have not attained unto the days of the years of the life of my fathers in the days of their pilgrimage. See, they had a pilgrimage. You read through the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter number 11, what the Bible talks about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. They understood that this was not it. Abraham went out not knowing whither he went. All he went was with a walk. All Abraham did when he left Ur of the Chaldees was go for a walk. God says, come on, walk with me. He says, okay. And he just walked with the Lord. But Isaac just walked with the Lord. And Jacob just walked with the Lord. Not a straight ascent, sort of a jagged up and down kind of thing. Just the way you and I, what? Walk with the Lord, right? A step forward, a step back, two steps forward, two steps back. But we what? We walk with the Lord. The Lord is moving on. And what we do? We just keep moving on, walking with the Lord. Learning how to put the foot of faith on the promises of God. And so he says, this has just been a pilgrimage. And Jacob blessed Pharaoh and went out from before Pharaoh. Now, it begins to talk a little bit about Joseph's grace with his brothers. Look in verse number 11. And Joseph placed his father and his brothers and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt. In the best of the land, we talked about, in the land of Ramses, and as Pharaoh had commanded. And Joseph nourished his father and his brethren, all his father's household, with bread according to their families. Now, this is just grace, because those boys certainly didn't deserve this kind of goodness from Jacob. They had from Joseph. They had mistreated him. They had sold him as a slave. They would not receive him. But when they finally repented, Joseph shows grace to them. Wonderful, marvelous grace. And see, we can see how he did. He gives them the best. And he calls them to draw near unto him. Be right here and enjoy the blessed. But I want you to see not only his grace, but I want you to see his government. Now, in verses 13 down to verse number 26, I want you to see his administrative skills. How many of you know that one day the kingdoms of this world are going to become the kingdom of our God and of his Christ? Jesus Christ is going to be the great administrator over this world and this world system. The Bible says the kingdoms of this world, the government shall be his responsibility. That's what it means to be upon his shoulders. He's going to bear the government. He is going to be the one sitting upon the throne. You follow what I'm saying? And we are going to see a benevolent dictatorship, a loving lordship. He's going to rule with a rod of what? Iron. But it will not be a malevolent, wicked, self-centered, self-interested, self-absorbed rulership. It will be a benevolent, loving lordship that is attending to the needs of those that he, and that's what the lordship of Christ is. How many of y'all know that the commandments of God are not grievous? God loves us. Now, the very love of God, God's expression of love to us, is his commandment to us. Did you know that? You want to know how God loves you? Why the Bible says, you know, we're to love the Lord and we're to keep his commandments. Well, you know, the proof of our love for God is our obedience to his commandments. But did you know that God's love for us in the first place is that commandment? I told you before, when God says, thou shalt do this, that, or the other, God is not acting as a cosmic killjoy trying to keep you from having fun. God's not trying to bust up fun. When God says, thou shalt not, what is he saying? Don't hurt yourself. It's like not like a bully that says, you do this and I'm going to get you. I remember when I first got saved, there was a song, I can't remember who sang it. God's going to get you for that? God's going to get you for that? Man, that'll make you neurotic, wouldn't it? The fact that God who sees it all going to get you for that? That's not how God operates. God is not a God looking for tit for tat. When God says, thou shalt not, he's trying to keep you, not like a bully saying, you do this and I'm going to get you. He's like a loving father or mother, a parent who says, you do that and you're going to hurt yourself. Right? Like, thou shalt not run with the scissors. Thou shalt not play marbles in the intersection. Right? Because in the day that thou doest it, thou shalt surely what? So God, now watch this. Here's how we have to see this, because the devil wants you to think negatively about God. And that's the nature of fallen flesh, to think negatively about what God intends for good for us. The commandments of God are not to be grievous. The commandments of God are to be seen as a display of his love for us. So he says, thou shalt. He says, thou shalt not. What is he saying? I love you. And then because we love him, we do what? We obey. That's why we ought to learn how to love our parents, even as in the natural world. When you love your parents, you what? You want to obey them. Now, I heard this said one time, and it's so true. When you're a little kid, if you had a daddy like me, all right, he'd get you, right? He'd tear your rear, he'd tan your hide. Some of y'all need a hide tanning, all right? Mine pretty tan, all right? But that's how he was. I don't think he was a mean man. I just think he would get you. He didn't play. He was not to be played with. He was not to be toyed with. All right? We knew that. All right? So, in fact, he'd look at you. You know what I'm saying? His silence was eloquent. You got the picture. So when a little kid like me, a 5-year-old, you know what you say? I'm going to do what daddy says, because if I don't, he'll hurt me. Right? But as I grew, this is maturity. When you grow, you understand the heart of your father who wants you to do right and wants you to learn a work ethic, wants you to do what, so the police won't have to get you. Right? Want to keep you out of prison, want to keep you out of trouble, want to keep you on the straight and narrow. You begin to understand that, and you begin to see that he was not an old meanie. What he said for love. What he did for love. Not perfectly, because he's not a perfect man. He's just a man. But we learn how to reverence our fathers, Hebrews 12, right? And he is working. Hey, God, he's trying to work something in us. But now watch this. Over here you said, I'm going to do what daddy said, because if I don't, he'll hurt me. But as you grow, you begin to say, I'm not going to do what daddy said because he'll hurt me, but I'm going to do what daddy said because I don't want to hurt him. You know what I'm saying? When you grow, right, you know how it is. Once you begin to understand that there are some things you can do that'll break your parents' heart, and that becomes the governing ethic of your life. The same thing is true with God. When you are young, you don't understand, like, God's going to get you for that, God's going to get you for that, and I better obey God, because if I don't, my transmission is going to tear up. Richard says, tear him up, God, tear him up. No. I'm going to tithe because if I don't, my engine's going to blow up. I'm going to tithe because, you follow what I'm saying? I'm going to do what God says, because if I don't, he'll get me. But as you grow, what do you realize? The heart of God is connected to this. And God says in Deuteronomy 5:29, oh, now listen, this is God. Oh, that they would fear me and keep my commandment always. Oh, that they would. Oh, that you would love him and fear him and keep his commandment always, so that it might be well with and with your children. God just cares about you. He cares about me. You see that? So we look at Joseph and we see these laws, we see this commandment, we see Joseph and his administrative ability, and then I want you to see that this pictures Christ. Notice here in verse number 13, we'll read a little bit now. And there was no bread in all the land, for the famine was very sore, a grievous famine, so that the land of Egypt and all the land of Canaan fainted by reason of famine. They are all in trouble. And Joseph gathered up all the money that was found in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan for the corn or the grain which they bought. And Joseph brought the money unto Pharaoh's house. Now here's what it is. The famine is on. It's grievous. And people are out of food. And guess who's got food? Joseph. God has given Joseph a dream. There's going to come a time of famine. Store up as much as you possibly can. And Joseph, in that 7 years of plenty, Joseph put away grain. I mean, every available place, every available warehouse, built warehouses for grain all over Egypt. So now they are in the midst of this gripping famine, and everybody's food runs out. People are landowners. They have that. Everybody's food runs out. And so you know what they did? They start coming to Joseph to do what? Buy grain. And Joseph was just collecting that money. And you know what Joseph was doing? Taking all that money and bringing it to Pharaoh. He kept all the money, everything that's possessed. He came and laid it at the feet of Pharaoh, the king on high, the most high. You see that? All the wisdom of Joseph to do the storing. He heard the voice of God who told him what to do in the time of plenty. Some of us need to learn. I know myself, the time of plenty is the time of preparation. It's time to get ready for the time of lack. That's why the Bible says consider the ant. The ant thinks summer all winter and winter all summer. It's always what? Preparing. Right? Not to prepare is to presume. Right? And God hates presumption. So now notice, he takes all the money. Now watch this. And when money failed in the land, y'all looking at verse number 15? And when money failed in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan, all the Egyptians came unto Joseph and said, give us bread, for why should we die in thy presence? For the money faileth. First of all, I just want to make this statement. Do y'all know that there's going to come a day in your life when money's going to fail? Do y'all realize that there's going to come a day when your money won't get you what you really need? There's only so much money can do. There's only so far money can go. There's going to come a day when everything you have in your hand means nothing. The one person you got to go deal with is Jesus. So the conditions are forcing and funneling and corralling everybody to Joseph. There's coming a day where everything is going to be corralled and brought in to Jesus. Amen. He is the creator of it all. But the Bible says by him all things consist. You know what that means? All things are held together. Jesus is the egg in the cake. You don't have the right amount of eggs in the cake, it ain't gonna hold together. In this whole universe, Jesus is the one who holds it together. And everything, all the conditions of the world, that's coming a day when every enemy is going to be subdued. Every person is going to have to do business with Jesus. And so now notice, money fail. Money's going to fail. Friendship's going to fail. All our resources are going to fail, and we're going to need a source, right? So now notice, they came, and they said, hey, why should we die in our presence for money faileth? Now, Joseph is not running a giveaway program here. He is taking from these. He is extracting. He is saying, what you have now belongs to Pharaoh. I'll give you food, but you got to give something. Now, notice what he says. And Joseph said, give your cattle. Right, you don't have money? Well, I'll take your cattle. I will give you for your cattle if you don't have money. You say, man, that's mean. You don't get a vote. How many of you know when Jesus, who created it all, and Jesus by whom all things consist, Jesus is going to come one day and claim it all. And you don't get a vote, and I don't get a vote. The kingdoms of this world are going to become the kingdom of our God, the Most High, and of His Christ, His anointed one. So the situation is bringing people. People got their money. They paid money till the money's gone. Now they're starving. They says, what else you got? Well, I got some stuff here. I got cattle. Verse 17, they brought their cattle unto Joseph, and Joseph gave them bread in exchange for horses and for flocks and for the cattle of herds and for the asses, and he fed them with bread for all their cattle for that year. Hey, we're so used to giveaway and demonstrating and all that, we don't see the benevolence in this. This is benevolent. That ain't the American way. Well, when that year was ended, they came unto him the second year. And he said unto them, they said unto him, we will not hide it from my Lord. By the way, there's going to come a day when nothing can be hidden. Just have to come and confess. I need you. No need me trying to posture. No need me trying to look like I ain't hungry. I'm hungry. And my pockets turned inside out. I got nothing. Here they are back the second year. We will not hide it from my Lord how that our money is spent. My Lord also has our herds of cattle. There is not aught left in the sight of my Lord but our bodies and our lands. In other words, all I got is me and the land I live on. Wherefore, now notice this. They're the ones who doing the suggestion here. Wherefore shall we die? Why in the world don't make sense us to die before thine eyes, both we and our lands? Buy us and our land for bread, and we and our land will be servants unto Pharaoh, and give us seed. We need something to eat. Give us grain that we may live and not die, that the land be not desolate. And Joseph bought all the land of Egypt for Pharaoh. For the Egyptians sold every man his field because the famine prevailed over them. So the land became Pharaoh's. And as for the people, he removed them to cities from one end of the border of Egypt even to the other end thereof. This is great organizational skill. This is great benevolent lordship. This is a benevolent dictatorship. Only the land of the priests bought he not, for the priests had a portion assigned unto them from Pharaoh, and they did eat their portion which Pharaoh gave them, wherefore they sold not their land. Then Joseph said unto the people, behold, I have bought you this day and your land for Pharaoh. Lo, here is seed for you, and ye shall sow the land. I'm going to give you something for you to live off of. Now watch this. When the famine is broken, who's got all the grain? Who's got all the seed? He says, I'm going to give you some. But now remember, the land you sow it on belongs to that Pharaoh. The seed comes from who? Pharaoh. I got it all. I'm putting it in your hands. And notice what he says. It shall come to pass in the increase that ye shall give 20% part. You say, all this mean? Hey, I take 20% taxes. this is just, all this is 20% taxes. This is a great deal. How many of y'all will jump on that? Folk who think that's bad ain't paying it. But here's what I want you to see. Here's what I want you to, I love this. I love the attitude that these people have, and desperation will bring you to this kind of attitude. The weight and the burden of it all will bring you to this kind of attitude. He says, I'm going to require 20% from you, a fifth part, all right? When your land begin to increase, when all that, a fifth part, except the land of the priests only, which became not Pharaoh's. Now notice, and what verse did I stop at? Verse 24, and it shall come to pass in the increase that ye shall give the fifth part unto Pharaoh, and the fourth part shall be your own. Isn't that benevolent? Isn't that good of God? Is God wrong to ask you for 10%? I kind of forced you into that, didn't it? All right. All right. Now, yeah, gotcha. 20%. You say, hey, that's pretty good. But God says, hey, to you, 10%. So he says, hey, 20%, four parts shall be your own for seed of the field and for your food and for them of your household and for food for your little ones. This is benevolence. They had nothing. Look at this attitude in verse number 25. They said, thou hast saved our lives. You know what that was? 20%. That's nothing. Is that all? 20%? That's a good deal. You saved our lives. That's not too much to ask. I love it. You saved our lives. This is the attitude we ought to have. What can the Lord ask us to do that's too much? He saved us. We'd have been dead and in hell. He saved us. Is there a place on earth to go to preach the gospel that's too far? Is there an amount to give out of our pocket and out of our store that's too much? He gave it to us in the first place. I love this attitude. This is the attitude we ought to have. Thou hast saved our lives. Let us find grace in the sight of my Lord, and we will be Pharaoh's servants. And Joseph made it a law over the land of Egypt unto this day that Pharaoh should have the fifth part. Now, even when Moses was writing this 400 years later, it was still done. Hey, guys, let me just tell you, let me give you some reading to do. I want you to read 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. It's talking about the resurrection, but around verse number 23, 24, and it talks about how all things are going to be subdued under Jesus. And he's going to reign until all enemies and everything is going to be brought in under him. You follow me? He's going to reconcile all things unto himself. This world that the devil seemed to be trespassing on, this world system, listen, all of it is going to be brought right back by Jesus and brought back under Jesus. And I want you to read that. And the Bible says once he has gotten all gathered up together, you know what he's going to do? He's going to take it and present it to God the Father. That's what that is right there. This is a picture. Joseph is our Old Testament picture of Jesus. And what Joseph does here is exactly what Jesus is going to do. He's going to come, rule with the rod of iron, bring all things unto himself. Everything will be subdued unto him. And then the kingdom shall be turned over to God the Father. Amen. What a beautiful picture. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for these men. Thank you, dear God, for the partnership, the privilege we've had, Lord, to partner with you with Stand 17. Lord, we rejoice in the blessing. We dare not take your glory. Lord, we don't want to accept praise from other people. We want to make sure, Lord, you get the praise, you get the glory for what you have done and what you're going to do. So help us to be careful, Lord. I know people around town are saying, Band of Brothers, y'all put on a good, all of this. Lord, help us to always understand that we are unprofitable servants. We're simply doing that which is our commandment, which is our duty to do. Help us to do it as unto the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
We trust today's message has been a blessing to you. You can forward this program to a friend who may need to hear the Word of God. Invite them to join you at the First Baptist Church in Garden City next Friday morning at 6:30. A hot meal is waiting for you. You can help the Kenny Grant Ministries. Contact us at the Kenny Grant Evangelistic Ministries.org. Thank you. May God's message be a blessing to you.
We're a band of brothers, just and perfect men, a broken host of sinners, made whole again. We praise you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. We're a band of brothers. Lead us in this place. We're a band of brothers. Lead us.